Today I'll be covering how you can make loops like these with any logo in Blender using geometry nodes. First, we're going to need the path for your logo, which you can import using the SVG file format if you have the vector file. If you only have an image, you can import it into Blender or Illustrator or Photoshop or Inkscape and recreate it using the curves in those programs. If you're using something other than Blender, just make sure to export as SVG. Once you have your SVG file exported, you can open up Blender. Let's just delete this original cube and then go File, Import SVG. And then you can find your SVG file in your folders. I just put mine in the downloads here. Blender. There we go. And then you can zoom in on the curves here. And let's just join them together with Control J once you have them both selected. There we go. If it appears weird like this, that's no problem. Just change it to 3D and that should be good to go. Now we're just going to set up the camera really quickly by selecting the camera and then hitting 0. And then moving these to 0, 0, 0. Oops, that is 9. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. And then I'm going to move this Z back so we can get a top down of the logo. Now you can see it right here. It's clearly not in the center. So we're just going to go to Object, Set Origin, Origin to Geometry. Not even close. Set Origin, Geometry to Origin. Other way around. I'm going to scale it up so it's around this large right here. Doesn't really matter. And then once you're happy with the size, you can just Object Apply Scale. So it goes back to 1 here. And now we're ready to set up the geometry nodes. So we can head over to the geometry nodes tab here. While having our curve selected, we can just hit new. And then this is the input of our curve, and this is the output that displays on the screen. Go to the camera view mode, and then we can add a new node by holding Shift A in this section here. And what we want to do is we want to add a resample curve node. We're just going to add that into here. We want to turn it up so we can see the full quality of our logo. I'm just going to turn this to something like 512. Next thing I want to do is add an instances on points node. I'm just going to use Shift A and search for it again, instances on points. I'm going to put that right here. It'll plug the points into the curves or the curves into the points here. And then we want to select an instance that's going to display on all of these points. So we're going to have 512. That might be a lot. For this, I'm actually going to turn it down just to 128 for now. It's because I don't want it to be too slow. I'm going to add a UV sphere onto this. And that'll be the instance. Might appear very large, and that's because the radius is pretty high for our scene because we're very zoomed in right now. So we can just turn it down to something like that. And now you might notice that these circles on the inner circles here are very close together. And that's just because their curve or their path is smaller than this other one. So what we want to do is instead of count, we want to set this to length, which will more evenly disperse the objects out. So now we can just put this to 005, for example. If you want more control over this, actually, what we can do, instead of just using this resample curve, if we want to set the resample curve to something high, let's add a points to curve node, or sorry, a curve to points node. Curve to points. And now once we set this really high, it won't affect the amount of circles here. This will change that, which will let us have a little bit more control over how high quality our logo path is versus the number of circles on our path, if that makes sense. Now we can change the length down here to 0.01 if we wanted to. And the spacing will be a lot more even on these inner ones now, which is exactly what we want. Just gonna turn this down a little bit right here. I think that looks pretty good. Also, if we wanna set a material onto this, we can just Shift A, search, and then set material, and we can put it right here. And then just select our material right here. Then once we go into the shader editor and then select that material, you can change the settings and then we can go into the viewport here, the render view. You can change it to whatever you'd like for now. We might change it later on when we add some lighting as well. Now we wanna make an animation out of this. So we wanna affect the scale here, but we wanna affect it all at once and we wanna have it animate and loop at the same time. So what we can do with this is we can use a wave modifier or a wave texture, sorry. And we could also alternatively use a noise texture. You have to use keyframes or some math nodes to make it multiply and get it back to its original state, which is really hard. But fortunately, the wave texture does this already with the phase offset. So we can just plug this factor into the scale here. And then we can change this to rings or anything you'd really like. I'm gonna use spherical for this. And then if you turn on the scale, you can kind of see how it looks. And then if you change the phase offset, you can see how the loop will look once we've started animating it. And we don't want to use keyframes for this because that's just going to take too long and it takes too long to customize and change. So what we're going to do instead is we're going to use a scene time node. We're going to plug the scene time node, the seconds into the phase offset, and then we're just going to hit play. and you can see it start to animate here. And let's say we want to speed up this animation or make it loop to a certain time. We just need to add a math node and then select multiply. And then we can just change the speed using this number right here, or this value right here. Another nice thing about the wave texture in comparison to the noise texture is that you can pretty much make this a noise texture as well by just increasing the distortion and the scale. And now it looks like it has no wave or no balance in the wave whatsoever. And obviously, as you increase this more, the more crazy it'll get. So to make it loop, we're just going to go to the timeline and I'm going to set it to something short, like 60 or 30. I'm going to go 30 for now. We can see, fortunately, I guess I got it to loop pretty close. But let's say we only had this at 0.1 for now, or like 0.1.1. We can see it's not even close to looping. We can circle in on a single instance and we can see that it does not loop at all. So if we just increase this more, now we can see we're about halfway there because it only gets halfway down. We can just increase this a bit more. Now we can see it almost gets up, but it's not all the way there. Let's increase it a bit more. Yeah, we can definitely see it pauses. So as you put it down a little bit more, you can see how naturally it flows now. Now if we want to make this easier for other people to edit with their own projects in the future, or even your other projects, you want to make it more customizable without having to go into this geometry node tree branch and like figuring out what everything does again, you can simplify this process by adding more inputs to this group input here. So what I mean by this is, let's say for example, you want to affect the speed of the scene without having to go in here. Let's just plug the value into this. And we can open up this menu here on this little button and then go to group, and then we see value. Instead of value, let's call this speed, or animation speed. Animation speed. And then you'll see when you go to the modifiers, you can see the animation speed right here. Now, we probably don't want the animation speed to be able to go that far down, because it could get kind of scary and kind of like insanely fast. Let's say we want to limit this for the person using it, or yourself using it, for example. And let's say we can change it to 0 to 10. So now this bar will only go from 0 till 10. Obviously 0 is no animation. And then you can change it like this by increasing the number like here and seeing it real time on the viewport. Now you can just choose what other options you might want to customize in the future. Maybe you just play around with it right now. This looks pretty cool when it's this low. So maybe I want to easily change this later on. Let's just plug this into here and we can keep length as length. That's fine for me. And then we can set the min maybe as 0.005 and then set the max as 0.1. 0.005 is like pretty crazy because it's so close together, so it's so many instances at one time. That's one thing that this is good for as well, is limiting the amount of instances you create so you're not making the person or yourself crash Blender in the future or something. So now I've just limited it a little too high. So maybe I want to do 0.0008. There we go. I think that's appropriate. Now we can get a good range of different abilities here. Another thing we might want to change in the future is the circle radius. So we can just select this and then do circle radius. And let's say it's 0.004 right now. So maybe that's the lowest, or maybe we can let it get to 0.002. Maybe the max we want is 0.01. So now the circle radius is easily changeable again. And remember, we want the animation speed to loop, so I'm just going to set it to 5. Now, instead of just all of these spheres appearing like this, I want them to have a more of a metaball effect where they feel more connected and smooth together. So all you really want to do is just add that modifier, and we're going to add a remesh modifier. You might not notice anything yet because it's not applied, and that's because it's only applying a remesh onto this curve that we have, which doesn't make any sense. So we want to hit geometry node to bring back this. And after the set material, we want to realize the instances. This will just create this into real geometry. It might be a bit more laggy. And right now, because it's remeshed, you won't see it. If we turn this off in the viewport view, you'll see that it is real instances now. It's really no different. But if we hit this, you'll see that it's not viewable at all. And that's because the voxel size is too high. If you turn it down more, you'll see it affect the logo more. So I'm going to go 0.001, sorry. And you can see how it already has that metaball effect right now. To make it speed up so it's not going like 7 frames a second, I would change the segments here down to like maybe 8 and 4. It might look a little worse just for now, but we can increase this when we want to actually render. And with your own logo, you might want to mess around with this voxel size more because it can really impact the look of it. You might want to just try lower values or higher values and then try maybe a smooth shading as well as the adaptivity. I think mixing the settings a lot can get you a really nice look and a lot of different effects. I think for me personally, I like this setting of this 0.0015 and then the 16 and 8 on the segments and rings. I think it looks pretty cool and I like how it connects here on the end a little bit. Now the one thing we still want to do is add the material back, and how we do this is a little bit kind of stupid, but what we do is we create a new plane and then we're just going to make this curve here that we created, this geometry node, disappear. And with this plane, we're going to create a new geometry node. And we don't actually want this plane at all, so we're just going to delete the input. We just want to drag this curve from over here into here, which will create an object info node, which we can drag the geometry from into here. It'll essentially duplicate our old curve that we had, but now this object separated, and now we can set the material. So we can set the material in this object separate from that one, if that makes sense. And then when we set it, it'll just be back to our original one. Now I think it's time we set up our scene a bit more, so I'm going to go to the shader editor, go to world, and I'm going to set the background as black. I'm also going to move this light around a bit more because I think the position of it is kind of bad right now. I always like to start from it in the center because maybe we want to do something from behind it where we like go like this. And we kind of just work on the outlines. Or maybe we want to put it in front of the logo. And up a bit more so we can get those shadows. I think this works well for me with the no metallic and full roughness. I think it's pretty basic, but it works. And now another cool effect that we can do to make this render a little bit cooler is we can rotate this. And maybe not so much that you can't make out the logo, so you want to be able to see what it is still. We also want to go to the camera, then go to the object data properties, and then go to depth of field here. And then we just want to change the distance so we can make out a clear part of the object. Just like that. And then maybe turn the f-stop to like 1.4. And then once you play it, you can kind of see how it has this like blur on the outside of it, even if you turn it down more like this. And what this also does is it helps make the remesh look a little cleaner because the voxels obviously aren't extremely clean. Which you could change as well in the settings of it. Maybe we can have this a little bit lower. That looks pretty cool. Might want to just mess with these materials a bit more. I just turned the metallic all the way up and then the roughness all the way down. I think this looks kind of cool as well. And maybe we want the f-stop a bit higher so it's not so blurry on the outsides. I wanted to keep messing around with it. I'd probably move the light around a bit more, see what other effects I could get from it. Like this, it's kind of cool, but you can't really make out what it is again. Now to export this, if you're using Eevee, you can turn on some of the settings you'd like, maybe ambient occlusion and bloom. If you want an alpha background, just open film here and then select transparent. If you want to export as a video directly, you can use FFmpeg video. You can't use alpha here, but if you want to export as a PNG sequence, you can use alpha, PNG, RGBA, and then you can change the color depth or the compression as you'd like. Make sure you have your frame rate correct, and then make sure you have the output folder set to where you want to output. If you've enabled ambient occlusion or bloom in here, make sure you have the render passes set for them as well. I have ambient occlusion on, and I have it on in here as well. And then I'm also going to enable transparent, just so I have that background. And then once you're ready and happy with your animation, you can hit render animation. And if you're using Eevee, it should be fairly quick. If you're using Cycles, it'll take a little bit longer. It'll also depend on the settings you have using Eevee. Alright, there's a little bit of a jump to the future because I didn't like the outro I filmed and I just finished editing. So I just wanted to say thank you so much for watching the video. I hope you learned something about geometry nodes today. If you want to post something or share it and you want to show me, I would love to check it out. I want to see a bunch of different variations of this. I'd love to see people's different takes on it and stuff like that. And also, if you want to see any other geometry node tutorials, let me know. I really like the idea of connecting programming and design to make all these customizable objects. And yeah. Thank you for watching, have a good day, and peace out.